गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, एम आई ऑडिबल? अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ एंड स्पीक। एम आई ऑडिबल? प्लीज कंफर्म।
यस मैम।
थैंक यू, थैंक यू सो मच। इट्स टू चेक द ऑडियो लाइक बिफोर स्टार्टिंग। सो Yesterday we did this poem of Joan Keats, A Thing of Beauty, right? Today we are going to discuss the question answers. Keep your book open, page number, it is, you can open page number 98, 99 also, because the questions are on page number 99. Now dear students, okay, yes, let's discuss the question answers and you know, list the things of beauty mentioned in the poem. List the things of beauty mentioned in the poem. What are the things of beauty? You can make a note. The things of beauty mentioned in the poem are the sun, the moon, the trees, the innocence of the sheep, the blossoming of daffodils, the meadows, daffodils in the meadows, you can say, the musk rose blooms. All these things are the things of beauty mentioned, the mass of ferns, the clear streams, lovely tales that we have read or heard. So all these are NCERT questions, children, that we are going to discuss. Very importantly, these NCERT questions we need to prepare first, then we prepare the other questions, the extracts and so on. So list the things that cause suffering and pain. We have done one word, despondence, yesterday. What is this? Causing pain, lack of noble natures. It causes pain when there will be no humanity in the society, when there will be no human feelings, no humanity, no concern for others. This will create pangs and pains. So what are the things that are being mentioned as painful things in the poem? They are lack of noble natures. You mark the lines, I'm reading from the lines only. Gloomy days, our dark ways, all these things are the things that cause suffering and pain. And how we get rid of them? By being in the company of nature. Therefore, are we reading a flowery bat to bind us to the earth? What does this suggest to you? An important line in the poem that we need to work upon, we need to practice it, revise it, revise it. Therefore, are we creating a bond with the earth? So man has always shared a special bonding with the earth, children. Man has always been creating bonds with the earth, with all the beautiful things. So here the poet wants to say that though the world is a beautiful place to live in, there is a lot of despondence, disappointment, sadness, and how this sadness can be removed. So that sadness will be removed when we create bondings, bonds with the earth, loving connections. And that can be injured by treasuring the happiness and the joy that beautiful things give us. So the poet asks, therefore, are we reading a flowery band to bind us to the earth? Keats believes, the poet believes that nature and man are woven together. Are we creating that bond? That means Keats is conveying that man and nature are woven together, are somewhere annealed in one another. Right? Now, the next point you can give is He believes that beautiful things present around us, like beautiful flowers, or the flowers are the symbol of beauty. So that's why he has used the word flowery band, beautiful band, band of love, or bond. That band here is symbol for bond of love, bond of connectivity. So are we binding us? Now band is what? See children, we have done the previous poem also. Band is something that you wear, put it around your wrist or some band. So that bind, band and bond. The poem talks of bond and binding. We have added from our own side the answer. Binding. What? So a band. Or then the symbolic meaning of that band, bond. The connection. I hope the things are clear. And let me tell you, if we go through the lines, there is alliteration in these lines. Right? How? A flowery band to bind. Example of, though we'll discuss all the figures of speech, right? So but you can underline in your book, like the lines are, a flowery band to bind. Band to bind. And then we find ourselves connected. So let's move on to the next question. What makes human beings love life in spite of having troubles and sufferings? I want someone to speak up and come forward. The question is, again, I'm repeating the question. What makes human beings love life in spite of challenges and problems? What is that thing that makes one fall in love with life? What are those things? See, when we talk of life, it is something meaningful, not meaningless. So in spite of sufferings, we have to find something that will make our existence meaningful. When we talk of life, please add a word meaningful. And when you want to make your life meaningful, you have to create that bond of love with human beings, with nature, with yourself, above all, with yourself. Right? So then you will be able to remove the gloom and the darkness that will fill your life with beauty and grace and happiness. The things of beauty bring love and happiness, and they remove sadness, despondence, right? Dissatisfaction, right? And so what makes human beings love life? The thing that makes human beings love life, because life is meaningful and it is more meaningful when you attach yourself, when you bind yourself with the finer things of life, and when you bind yourself with nature, when you create those bonds of love, happiness, joy, giving, sharing, concerning, and also, right, receiving from nature. What is when you are in the company of nature, you give, but you take more. You soothe yourself, right? So giving and sharing and taking keeps on going. It is in giving that we share. What makes human beings love life? The beauty, the meaningfulness of life, right? Why is grandeur associated with mighty dead? The point that I gave you yesterday was regarding this question, was that we have buried a mighty dead there. Another thing which is coming into my mind right now is, which I wish to share with you, is that we make tombs, monuments. If you see the monuments of the world, sometimes they are constructed in memory of someone great, someone mighty, someone loved, someone who was being loved. So two things can be there, that why might word is associated, grandeur associated with the dead. Because we erect, we construct tombs, monuments, memories, memoirs in memory of dead, whom we loved, whom we cared, who loved us, who cared for us. So that's why there is grandeur associated with mighty dead. Right, students? Have you understood the question? Now, do we experience things of beauty only for short moments, or do they make a lasting impression on us? What do you say? Do we experience things of beauty only momentarily in a transitory way, or they leave indelible marks, they leave influences, they leave some memories and some important, you can say, everlasting impressions? What do you say? Unmute yourself, one of you, and you can answer this question, I suppose. Shalini, can you speak better? Nachiket?
Yes, ma'am. Everlasting impression.
You will answer?
Yes, ma'am. Everlasting impression.
Okay, everlasting impression. Do we experience things of beauty only for short moments? No. They actually, what Shalini said is absolutely right, that everlasting moments, they're not short. They're eternal. Yesterday we discussed these words, eternal. And I gave you an opposite also of this, of short-lived. So what was that? Please tell me. You attended the class yesterday, you all were there. Opposite of eternal, I believe. Fine, short-lived is there, but one word I need. Anyone? Unmute yourself. Aris? Okay. Okay, okay. I wrote the opposite this way only. You soon remember. Remember? See. E-P-H-E-M-E-R-A-L. Right? So are the things of beauty eternal or ephemeral? Please tell me. Now answer my question. Kavya, am I like right, correct in pronouncing your name?
No, ma'am.
It is? Please tell me.
Favia. Favia.
Okay. So Favia, please tell me the answer. What? Where you will put the thing of beauty? Here or here?
Eternal. First.
Yes.
Eternal.
Things of beauty are? Thing of beauty is?
Eternal.
Eternal. A long lasting impression it will have. I hope this answer is clear. The grandeur example, then mighty dead, then experiencing beauty for a short period or a permanent impression they have. These poets, Wordsworth, Keats, they used to go out and come back and write poetry. If you remember, A Solitary Reaper, if you have read in your junior classes. Solitary Reaper, he went out in the hilly area and came back and wrote the poetry which became so popular. William Wordsworth's A Solitary Reaper. Will no one tell me what she sings? And the echo of the song went on and went on in his heart. So everlasting impressions. Now, what image does the poet use to describe the beautiful bounty of the earth? The earth is bountiful, students. The earth is very, very bountiful, we all know. It has pleasures, treasures. It has its own beauty to give to the whole world. The poet uses the expression, an endless fountain of immortal drink. This is the line that tells that earth is bountiful. Right? The endless fountain of immortal rain pouring into us from the heaven spring. It is coming from somewhere from the heaven. And it is pouring. It is pouring on to us. Into us as well as on to us. Right? On us, it is reaching within. This fountain of beauty is eternal in the world. Right? In various forms of beauty. And it is reaching to our heart. So it is an eternal fountain. It is a fountain of joy, happiness. Final last line, what does a thing of beauty give to you? Happiness. Right? Everlasting happiness, joy, creativity. Okay? Now, let's move to the figures of speech. You have to keep your pencil in your hand and you have to mark fast. Like, I'll give you the examples. right? And we discussed the, you know, figures of speech. Now, please mark down metaphor. Metaphor. When we assume one thing as the other, the figure of speech is metaphor. Figures of speech in the poem. Every poem we discuss for 5 minutes, these, because one or two marks may be they are utilized for this. So metaphor. I'm writing, the thing of beauty has assumed as a shade. Right? There is a phrase in the poem, there is in the first few lines only, that it will keep you or give you a shade of quietude. So, right? Then metaphor. What metaphors are there? Flowery band. So here we are considering thing of beauty as that flowery band, assuming one thing as the other. And when like and as are there, it becomes simile. Then we have endless fountain. Endless fountain. Fountain. Thing of beauty or things of beauty are eternal fountains. A fountain which is pouring from the heaven. So I hope these metaphors are clear. One more metaphor example is there in the line where there is the word ball, cover. So it removes the cover also. So assuming this also. Now when we move to alliteration, another figure of speech, I hope the screen is clear, alliteration. The repetition of same sounds, you know. Can you give me an example of alliteration which is covered in the poem? Please. I have used just now in the class. So it is. Just now I used with the word be. What was that? Bind, ban, ban to bind. Ban to bind, alliteration. Ban to bind. So BB sound is repeated. Alliteration. Then cooling covered. Cooling covered. Noble natures. All these are examples of what? Noble natures. All these are examples of alliteration. So metaphor and alliteration. These are one or two marks are reserved for figures of speech. Generally one, but we can't leave. 5 poems are there and we'll prepare all the figures of speech this week. Is this much clear? Metaphor and alliteration, clear? Responses awaited. Clear? Unmute yourself and speak when I ask responses.
Yes, ma'am.
Very good. So, now children, symbol. Symbolism, symbol. Symbol. So like sheep, simple sheep. Simple sheep. The sheep are the symbols of we people, surrounded by the great shepherd, I call you. Right? So there is the perceptions of various readers bring out various notions. How we perceived this line yesterday, how we understood this line yesterday. That simple sheep. The sheep is also the sign of beauty on the earth. Right? The great Lord was surrounded by sheep, if you know. Right? So, and he is the master, shepherd, and we as sheep. The sheep, symbol of the innocence of human beings. The innocent human beings who are taken care by the great, great shepherd. Right? Who is that shepherd? Great Lord, Almighty. So this way, the sheep are the symbol of that innocence. Refers to mankind. What answer you write in the exam? If it comes 1 mark, what do you mean by sheep here? Why the poet has used the term sheep and why the flock of sheep here is so crucial, so important, significant. They actually signify mankind right down there. Okay, I hope you have understood now. Endless fountain, hyperbole. Which figure of speech? 1, 2, 3, and then hyperbole. Hyperbole. When you actually exaggerate the things, when there is more, because here the poet is saying that fountain, the fountain which is endless. So there's bit extra praise for that, little extra ounce of praise for that fountain, that it is everlasting, it is always coming and moving and pouring onto us, and it is eternal, and which is flowing from the brink of heaven. So bit of little exaggeration is there. When you exaggerate, so the example is endless example of hyperbole in the poem. Endless fountain. Endless fountain. You can note that. Right? Endless, and write properly so that you can see the word fountain here. Endless fountain. Endless fountain. Okay? Clear? You can note down if you wish to. Right? Figures of speech in the poem. Metaphor. Quiet power, quiet shade. Breathing a flowery band, endless fountain, fall, an alliteration band to bind, green covered noble natures. Symbol, simple sheep. Hyperbole, exaggerating the things a little bit. Even more also, so endless fountain, everlasting fountain. Now, one more figure of speech I would like to share with you, that is transferred epithet. Have you heard of this term? Just learn it. What is the example of transferred epithet in the poem? First, mark in the lines or circle the phrases in your book. You can write transferred epithet, gloomy days and unhealthy and overdarkened days. There's a phrase, gloomy days. So I'm writing on the board the next one. This is the first one, this is the second one, transferred epithet. Example, gloomy days. Gloomy days. Right? And this is the fifth one. Number five. Now, transferred epithet. What is this transferred epithet? What do you mean by the term transferred epithet? Epithet means a descriptive word. And gloomy days. If you see this phrase, gloomy days. Gloomy days. So days are being described with gloomy word. Gloomy is doing the function of that descriptive word. But days are never gloomy, people are gloomy. So when the poet associates such combinations, where the adjective is not associated, but he associates, so we call it the figure of speech, transferred epithet. Now what transferred epithet? The epithet takes the charge or the responsibility of epithet here is gloomy. The descriptive word here is, adjective here is gloomy. And the days are being described as gloomy. And gloomy and days have no connection because days are not living beings like us. But the poet has created that coin, that phrase. And it is what example? Transferred epithet. Clear, children? One more example we can search in the lines. If I get, I'll tell you. Over darkened ways, unhealthy ways, and over darkened ways. So unhealthy ways. Have you understood this? Any query related to this, you can unmute and ask me. Anything related to whatever we have discussed, and I hope this much of figures of speech are sufficient for this. A thing of beauty is joyful, a metaphor, transferred epithet, alliteration, symbol, symbolism, you can say an hype. Endless word tells us that there is hyperbole. And simple sheep, here are the symbols for innocence of human beings, mankind, innocent mankind. Those who allow themselves to be run as per the wish of the mighty Lord. So simple sheep. Then metaphor, it's clear when we assume one thing as the other. So here thing of beauty has been assumed as white place, white shade, then flowery band, then fountain also, it has been assumed as endless fountain. So it is also a metaphor also, right? Endless fountain, thing of beauty, or the things of beauty are endless fountains. So here we are doing assumption also. So this way we get excited to one thing after the other. You can unmute and ask me the queries first. Then I'll end my class and we'll continue with the next topic. Make some notes in your books only. Circle the figures of speech, write them, metaphor or alliteration or wherever there are similes in poem 1, poem 2, right? So, yes, Aris, Fabia, Shalini, Nachiket, unmute yourself, better, all of you. Any query? Hey, Baba, speak up.
No, ma'am.
Okay, very good. Very good. The poem, the chapters, the lessons, the poems that I've taught, are they clear? Because we are doing these days the poetry part.
Yes, ma'am.
Very good. God bless you. I'm ending my class. Okay? We'll continue in the next session.